In this lecture video, we will discuss the concept of central venous pressure and the factors that affect it. To begin, let's define a few terms: venous capacity, venous return, and central venous pressure. First, let's discuss venous capacity. Think about going to a restaurant, and they always have the sign that says, "Maximum capacity is," and some number. This sign tells you the maximum number of people you should have in that establishment. That is similar to venous capacity. Venous capacity indicates the volume of blood that the veins can accommodate. Now let's focus on venous return. Venous return is the volume of blood that returns to the heart. Finally, you will need to be familiar with the term central venous pressure, or what we call CVP. Central venous pressure is the pressure in the large veins of the thoracic cavity. This would include the inferior vena cava and the superior vena cava. All right, so let's start thinking about how increasing or decreasing venous capacity or venous return affects central venous pressure and vice versa. For example, if central venous pressure increases, what will happen to venous return? Will a patient with an increased central venous pressure have more blood flowing into the heart or less? More blood. You're correct. So increasing central venous pressure increases venous return. Okay, so if the patient has an increased venous return, how is that going to affect the volume of blood in the ventricles before contraction? It increases, right? You have just defined what's called the end diastolic volume, EDV. The end diastolic volume is the maximum amount of blood in the ventricles before contraction. So let's continue with the idea of increasing the venous return. Again, if you increase venous return, that will increase the end diastolic volume. So what will that do to the patient's cardiac muscle? Is the cardiac muscle going to stretch or not? A greater volume of blood causes more stretch toward the optimal length, which will increase the number of cross bridges that can form and will cause the force of contraction to increase. As a result, this will cause the stroke volume to increase. Okay, let's return for a moment to the increased force of contraction. How did this affect the patient's end systolic volume? Remember, the end systolic volume, or the ESV, is the maximum amount of blood in the ventricles after contraction. The patient just had a huge contraction, so is there going to be more or less blood in the ventricles after that contraction? Less. Therefore, the end systolic volume will be lower. Okay, let's return to the stroke volume. Earlier, we said that the patient's stroke volume would increase due to the increased central venous pressure. How does stroke volume affect cardiac output? Remember that cardiac output is equal to heart rate times the stroke volume. So if stroke volume increases, so does your cardiac output. And remember that this will also increase the mean arterial pressure, which is the pressure in the aorta during one cardiac cycle. All right, so to recap, if we alter central venous pressure, that will indirectly influence your mean arterial pressure. And remember that mean arterial pressure influences how much blood is delivered to your organs.